New Hampshire is one of the most beautiful states in the country. We're blessed with mountains, a sea coast, and diverse woodlands. And many of us take advantage of these natural resources, but, you know, we never seem to have time to just sit back and relax and enjoy its beauty. Well, that's about to change. Welcome to Windows to the Wild. I'm Willem Lange. We're presenting a series of programs that record the beauty and diversity and character of New Hampshire's outdoors. During the next half hour, we'll show you a window through which you can enjoy the wonderful sights and sounds and feel the peace of this magnificent part of the world. Today, for example, we're paddling the Connecticut River from Reigate, Vermont, down through Woodsville, New Hampshire. Let's go. Connecticut, longest river in New England, about 400 miles all the way from the Canadian border down to Long Island Sound at Old Saybrook, Connecticut. Its highest headwater is a little tiny beaver pond called Fourth Connecticut Lake. Just above the lake is a trickle of water coming down from the Canadian border. That was negotiated in 1842 by Daniel Webster and Lord Ashburton of England. They decided that the Connecticut River headwaters would be the boundary between the United States and Canada. Has been ever since. There's been some dispute about which was the highest headwater, but it's pretty well settled now. The name Connecticut is from the Abenaki Quinictucut, which means the long river. And it was first discovered by Europeans, by Adrian Block, a Dutch sailor in the 1600s. Others had seen it, but he was the first one ever trying to get up it in his boat. It was about a little 45-foot ship. Can you imagine crossing the Atlantic in a 45-foot boat in the 1600s? It was called the Restless, the Onrust. And he was able to go up the river as far as Enfield Falls in spite of sandbars and all kinds of problems on the way. The Connecticut, for most of its length, forms the boundary between New Hampshire and Vermont. It comes into between the two states at Beecher Falls, Vermont. It's also a Canadian border station. And then it's kind of like a big zipper. It goes all the way down between the two of them. New Hampshire owns it, by the way, through a fluke of politics a couple hundred years ago. New Hampshire owns the river over to the Vermont shore. Which means that New Hampshire gets to maintain the bridges, although it owns them. And it's probably one of the best-kept recreational secrets in the eastern United States. When you look at it, here we are alone on the river today, beautiful day. That wouldn't happen almost anywhere else. Cute little set of currents going right through there. The bow's about to swing right. There she goes. That's called a current shear. And we'll put you right ashore right there. Thank you. Now, the geology of the Connecticut River Valley is kind of interesting. Most of the rocks that are in this valley at one time were underwater. They were the continental shelf that went out into the ocean from the Adirondack Dome to the west, sort of the way the continental shelf is now off the coast of Maine and Newfoundland. And then about 500 million years ago, what's now the continent of Africa moved across what was now the Atlantic Ocean and crashed into this section of shelf over here and caused a lot of mountain building. The Green Mountains were pushed up then. The White Mountains also were grown then, but they were grown from volcanoes that erupted or pushed up all up and down the Connecticut Valley in the spine of what's now the White Mountains. That was all about 450, 500 million years ago. And you can, to this day, you can find the contact over near Killington between the Adirondack Dome, which is over a billion years old, and the rocks that came from the east that are only 450 million years old. Kind of a dramatic thing to span that much time. But anyway, during the Pleistocene era, the valley was covered with ice several times. As the continental ice sheets came down, it was buried quite deeply. And after the last one, the Wisconsinian retreated about, 8,000 to 12,000 years ago. And as it retreated, of course, it dropped all those rocks and boulders. But every once in a while, it would be in equilibrium for a while. It wouldn't advance or retreat, but it kept on dumping boulders. And it piled up great mounds of glacial boulders and gravel. Long Island is one example of that. Cape Cod is another. And on this river, down near New Britain, Connecticut, it piled up a huge dam across what's now the valley and then kept on retreating. And after it retreated, there was a lake here all the way from New Britain right up to Woodsville, which is just about where we started today. If you look across the river here, you can see that bank up there above us. That's the bottom of that old glacial lake. It was named Glacial Lake Hitchcock. And of course, as the dam broke, the river began to flow down through here, and it cut its way down through those old lake sediments. As you go down the river, you'll see more and more of it. In Hanover, New Hampshire, for example, the College Green is the bottom of the lake. And the depth of the lake, you can tell because it was just about as deep as the top of the College Library Tower. Not too deep a lake, but it was all this length down through here. And as you paddle this river, you'll see ledges of rock on your right and none on your left. That's because the river follows the course of an old fault in the earth, and the fault is what's called a thrust fault. This block has dropped down and is moving under the western block, which is why you see the cliffs there. One of these days that old fault may begin to move again. I don't think we'll be around to see it, but that would be kind of interesting. Things will be a little shaky here. Maples, swamp maple, blowing upside down. You know you're going to get wet in a little while. I'm glad we brought our raincoats. We've got a little bit of a riffle coming up. We must be coming almost to Woodsville. And I think if I stay left, I'll be okay. I'm gonna stand up for a minute and take a look at that. Oh yeah, we're all right. The rapids are on the right. Pleasant place to have a camp. Anytime you want a trout dinner, just slide right down onto that ledge. Nice aerated water there. Beautiful. This looks like a crib that they put up in the river during the log driving days to hold back logs. And if you look downstream, you'll see a rapid, so you know why they wanted to hold the logs here in case there was a pileup, a jam in the rapids down below. The river is too wide here for a single boom to go the whole length. It would break under the pressure of the logs. So they put up, during low water, they built cribbing out of logs, you know, crisscross logs, and then they fill it with stones and then attach chains from it to the shore with a floating log boom. And then when the logs come down the river, they can hold them here until they want to let them go. Then they can let one side of the boom go, or the other, or both, and let the logs run through. Think of the work it took to build that thing with just oxen and horses and men and crowbars. But it stood up all these years. Okay, and down below us now, we got some rapids coming up, which is the reason, no doubt, that cribbing is there. There were several along the river before the dams were built, but Woodsville was always exciting for the loggers for several reasons. One, the river gets a little narrower here and picks up speed, so if any logs jam on the islands in Woodsville, you've got an awful mess. And because of the speed of the current, it was quite a job to pick them, they called it, to find the log that was holding everything up. They didn't use dynamite until all the last few log drives. Before that, it was all pick poles and PVs and just grit, muscle, and horses sometimes to pull the logs free. That must have been something. Can you see logs coming through there, bank to bank, several logs deep in the springtime? And those poor guys in their wool pants, cut off up at the knees, freezing to death all day long, eating salt pork and beans and biscuits and cookies. They used to bring the cook raft down the river with the drive and a few horses on board to pull it where they couldn't use the current. But the cook was right there with his stove and all his supplies, several bateaux so he'd go ashore and get more, or bateaux to pull him out of trouble. And he'd try to be with the drive every day. And we'd park it, cook lunch, and then the cookies, his helpers, would take the lunch out to the men with sap yokes, a bucket hanging on each end of it. Boy, this current goes everywhere here. That's why so few of us go upriver, you know. That's an awful job. You need a pole and lots of grit and human nature. But this is lovely going down. Thank you. exciting. So far, so good. We got a cross current here. We're going to go back up river. We're not careful. Luckily, it's a big boat, but that may not cut much ice. Almost. Very nice. Quite painless. We just came through the narrows at Woodsville, which was a little exciting in this stage of water. I imagine it'd be a little more exciting with a few more feet. But that current just goes everywhere, the eddies and whirlpools and swirls. And the biggest problem, of course, is when you have current that comes into a back eddy. One end of your canoe wants to go in one way, and the other wants to go the other. All you could do is brace yourself and lean downstream, which we did rather successfully, and we're through it. Well, it's been kind of a hot, muggy, threatening day, but we've gotten to a campsite before the rain has gotten to us. I can hear thunder in the distance, so it's about time to set up our tent and tuck in for the night. I'm Willem Lange, and I'll see you outdoors.